Good morning, everybody. So welcome to VAST again, Video Assisted Skill Transfer on Retina. So my topic is retina detachment. When you are treating a patient with retina detachment, you have to first do the vitrectomy part. Vitrectomy part should be completed very carefully, starting from the core vitrectomy, keeping the suction at the higher side, in the core mode, that cutting at the lower side. And peripheral vitrectomy, for that, you have to keep your cutter on the saving mode, that is suction in the lower side, higher side, and cutting on the lower side. Now next step is PVD induction. It can be done without PFCL or with PFCL. With PFCL, initially without PFCL, like without PFCL, you can induce the PVD from the posterior pole, then trim it as such, then you can give support to the posterior pole by the heavy fluid PFCL, and then you can induce the PVD from the peripheral side. And in other situation, without PFCL, you can induce PVD, but there is always chance of retinal incarceration or iatrogenic break formation in this type of procedures. Like, in next step is membrane peeling. When you are getting the PVR, that is fixed fold, the star fold is the hallmark of PVR, PVD induction, another thing, so it should be, in that situation, PVD induction should be completed bimanually. You have stained the highlight phase with the triamcinolone acetonide, then you are inducing PVD bimanually with the help of engrapping, first engrasping forceps, as well as your light pipe or cutter. You can just trim it and just trim the peripheral part. Now to doing the membrane peeling. Next step is membrane peeling, that is star fold management. Star fold management, you can do it by just releasing the fixed folds. Then after maximum releasing the first fixed fold, you have to check the whether fixed fold, residual fixed folds are there or not. So you have to inject PFCL, stabilize the posterior fold, just assess whether how much fixed folds are there, remnants, fixed folds are there, and just remove the membranes. And you have to see the opacities overlying the vessels. That means the fixed folds are there. Sometimes bimanual membrane peeling is more necessary in case of far more PVR changes, not PVR D1, it is PVR D2 like or D3 like situations. D2 like situation here, I am inducing PVD, I am releasing the fixed folds with the help of engrasping forceps and the ALM peeling forceps. And after doing the release of fixed fold as much as possible, not 100%, I should not say, you can assess the part after injecting the PFCL. Another thing, you can realize this type of situation, intrinsic retinal contraction, when you are doing fluid exchange. So you have to make the infusion on again and try to do liberal relaxing retinotomy to release all the fixed fold, all the residual intrinsic contraction, and do the fluid exchange, do laser. Now coming to the phakic retinal detachment case, they are a very tricky situation, because when you are going to the periphery to do the vitreous base excision, sometimes this kind of situation, lens stress can happen. So it will deobody the surgery in a phakic case. So you should use a sandless light and depress the vitreous base and do PVD, do vitreous base excision carefully, inducing depressing the external vitreous base depression. And in case of while doing the vitreous base excision, it can be done without PFCL or with PFCL. Without PFCL situation, retinal suddenly bullous configuration may happen on table, that may jeopardize your surgery sometimes. Or with PFCL, you can always fix your posterior pole with the help of PFCL, and you can do PVD induction. Then next step is internal drainage of subretinal fluid. With the help of PFCL, you can just inject over the posterior pole, and the whole subretinal fluid will steamroll out through the peripheral bags. Another situation, you can just do the posterior pole retinotomy, and especially in the supranasal nasal area or most bullous area, you can just drain the whole SRF and do the laser around the retinotomy as well as the peripheral bags. Now, sometimes you can drain the total whole SRF by filling the vitreous cavity fully with the help of PFCL, and then you can do laser under the PFCL. Laser under the PFCL is very safe. It cannot give you this kind of situation like blobbing. Blobbing during laser is a very common situation, and it means there is presence of subretinal fluid. So you have to aspirate gently the subretinal fluid part, and you can do the laser around your break, iatrogenic break. So these things to be general things to be remembered before doing retinal detachment surgery. Now coming to the special situation, retinal detachment with dropped link IUL. So sometimes IUL can be dropped, and with the haptic of the IUL, some iatrogenic break or pre-existing breaks are there and dropped high IOL situation, you have to always redo, you have to always remove all the vitreous adhesions around the IOL, and you can use very safe technique by using the silicon tip backfast needle to bring the IOL just behind the pupillary plane, and you can prolapse the IOL inside the anterior chamber. In this situation, fortunately anterior capsular rim was there, so I have placed the IOL in the sulcus and treated the case as a pseudophakic retinal detachment. Just see the integrity of the IOL placement, then you can do the surgery as a case of pseudophakic retinal detachment. Now, in situation where there is dropped crystalline lens with retinal detachment, this is a post-traumatic case, dropped crystalline lens was there. Fortunately, patient was very young, so I could have managed the case with the help of cutter only, but sometimes you have to use the phacofragmentation. There was GRT, temporal giant retinal tear. You have to remove all the adhesions, vitreous adhesion around the giant retinal tear, and do. It is especially important, you have to inject PFCL, just go behind the crystalline lens, and the configuration of the PFCL, anterior surface, superior surface, it is convex, so the cataract will go periphery. So try to bring it centrally and just cutter, with the help of cutter only. In this special decision, in young patient, I am doing the lensectomy part. So with the help of cutter only, you can manage the situation and then manage the case as a case of GRT as usual. I will come to the next part. Now, next thing is, after this thing, you can sometimes you can face the situation like fundal coloboma with retinal detachment. Sometimes this kind of situation break can be there at the margin of fundal coloboma, or it can be inside the colobomatous area, or it can be anywhere in the periphery. So here in this case, break was there inside the colobomatous area. So if possible, you can drain through this area, or if possible, you can make another separate retinotomy, especially in the non-vital area like supranasal area, where it will and do the fluid directions radically without any help of injecting PFCL. So another situation, and do the laser around the retinotomy as well as all around the colobomatous area as well as 360 periphery. And the other situation where you cannot getting any break at the margin, because the retina is rudimentary in that area, and in other situation where you are getting the break at the peripheral break, that is the lattice and with hole, and got this kind of situation here, and so in this situation you have to remove all the vitreous fractions around the lattice and hole, then you can inject PFCL to steamroll out the subretinal fluid through the peripheral break and do the fluid exchange to remove all the anterior subretinal fluid and do laser around the that whole part, and carefully it should like around the all 360 periphery as well as the colobomatous margin of the coloboma, because the what I was telling you that and you should be very careful while doing laser at the macular area, because sometimes this kind of patient are maybe one-eyed, so you have to just do one or two rows of laser at the margin of coloboma, especially at the macular region. Now, another situation is macular hole retinal detachment. Sometimes this can this type of situation can arise without any preoperative when you have not noticed the presence of macular hole preoperatively, and sometimes this kind of situation is associated with the peripheral breaks. So you have to stain the internal limiting membrane with the help of brilliant blue GRD dye under the ear, or you can directly inject the BVG dye in the saline also. So IOL peeling, it can be done on the mobile detached retina, or it can be done under the PFCL. On mobile detached retina, it is very difficult to peel the IOL because there is no counter traction. There is no counter traction. Sometimes with this patchy removal of IOL is possible. Fortunately, I have done in this case, but sometimes it is very difficult to peel the IOL in this situation. Now you can routinely, you can inject PFCL again and to steamroll out the SRF through the peripheral breaks. Now sometimes you have to do the IOL peeling under the PFCL. I should say the IOL peeling under PFCL, it is very safe and very, you can do it very controlled manner, and just under PFCL you always get the counter support of the counter traction of the PFCL, the retina will not be mobile, With the help of Ingress Infocell also, you can do the ILM peeling under PFCL very well. And this case was associated with the peripheral break. So after that, you can do the manage the case as usual. All these things are basically not to do laser around the macular hole, because already the patient is having compromised central visual acuity. The prognosis will be much more worse. So ILM peeling under PFCL, it should be the method of choice for the detachment with macro hole cases. Now coming to the situations with giant retinal tear. In this post-traumatic case, with ragged margin, giant retinal tear is there with Acula on case, 6-9 vision. So you have to operate this kind of eyes, whereas a little bit of detachment was there around the tear. So vitreo retinal approach is basically necessary, because you cannot cover this whole break with the help of only the scleral buckle. So VR approach is better, always better in case of this kind of situation. You have to cauterize all the margin, trim the margin, and do good vitreous base excision around this infusion cannula as well as the periphery. So simple fluid exchange without any help of PFCL can manage this kind of situation, and you can do laser around the break. Now coming to the situation where you are getting giant retinal tear with frank detachment, subtrotal detachment. Like in this situation, there is giant retinal tear with more than temporal half detachment was there. You can see the ragged margin here, and you have to do good vitrectomy, followed by you can just trim the margin of the giant retinal tear, and you can you have to inject the PFCL, especially in this kind of situation where the frank detachment is there. You have to always inject the PFCL and drain the peripheral drain the fluid SRF through the peripheral breaks, and also see the vitreous adhesions around your left-handed cannula and trim all the good vitreous excision to remove all the vitreous adhesions around the cannula as well as the peripheral part of the retina. And don't try to separate the PVD part like you should not be desperate enough to separate the PVD part at the periphery. You will to prevent the further iatrogenic break formation. So after trimming all this anterior flap of the giant retinal tear, and especially considering the cornu area, you can do start doing fluid exchange. And in this situation, there was sac, JRT margin was sacked down, and this is a very common situation, and you have to inject more PFCL to separate. Basically, this indicates that the fluid layer is there in between the PFCL as well as the air bubble. So you have to inject PFCL bubble more to just beyond the GRT margin to drain out all the anterior subretinal fluid at the GRT margin here. GRT margin. So then you can do jolly well laser around the breaks as well as cornu part. Now another situation where most important part another is this PFCL silicon oil exchange. PFCL silicon oil exchange in this type of GRT cases, it is very important. A lot of techniques are there, but in my I am following this technique, injecting the silicon oil with the left hand and injecting silicon oil with the left hand, and keeping your right hand backflow needle inside the PFCL. So, and for that only, you have to use the Sandler slice as a fourth port. So inject the PFCL with the help of passive suction of this backflow needle, you can just aspirate out the PFCL bubble from the retinal surface, and you can complete the job. Now coming to the another situation where the giant retinal tear flap is totally inverted margin of the giant retinal flap. So in this situation, you have to invert it again and inject the PFCL just over the retina to reappose the retinal flap and do laser, do fluid exchange and do laser like this. Now another situation when we are getting cataract with retinal detachment. Cataract to retinal detachment is also a very tricky situation. So you have to perform the cataraxis under grayish glow. So you are not getting the good glow. After putting the IUL, you should treat the case as a pseudophakic retinal detachment, doing vitrectomy, removing all the adhesions around the breaks and HSTs, inferior break was there, and manage the case as usual. Now, sometimes the old IT with multiple retinal cysts were there, so inferior retinal contraction is there, and sometimes these cysts can hamper your laser part. Now, coming to the, I'm straight away going to the macular surgery. Gopal, next part is macular surgery.
Okay, please.
So, I'm straight away going to the my next topic, macular surgery. First thing is epiretinal membrane. Epiretinal membrane is a very basic thing. After doing proper vitrectomy, you have to stain the epiretinal membrane with the help of Titan glue, under keeping injecting under air. Then just most prominent and most thickened area of epiretinal membrane should be picked up and peel the membrane from the retinal surface. Sometimes when you are peeling the ERM, sometimes the ILM also, underlying ILM also can be peeled out because it is also very tightly adhered to the ERM. So you have to recheck it again with the help of brilliant bougie dye, and then residual ILM part has to be removed because I have stained the ILM with the help of BBG dye, and then I'm staining the, removing the ILM part to prevent the recurrence of epiretinal membrane formation. Now, second situation after ERM, it is macular hole surgery. Macular hole surgery, PVD induction most is the most trickiest part, and you can do it with the help of cutter only, or you can use the suction of the cutter only, or you can use the silicon tip drag cross needle. So PVD induction by suction of the cutter, or then after PVD induction, you have to stain the ILM by injecting BBG dye. BBG dye can be applied in the water or you can apply it under air. So here I am applying it in the water and just wait for, sometimes I think 2 to 3 minutes wait is enough to stain the ILM. Now after doing staining the ILM properly, you have to raise the flap. So creating flap is most important, and you can do it at the most convenient area for the surgeon, whichever you want. Like you can choose your infranasal area, or you can choose the infratemporal area, no hard and fast rule. But I am doing it from the margin of the macular hole. You can do it as a from the clockwise direction, or you can do it as a anti-clockwise direction. So you can peel as an onion peel technique. I can do it as an onion peel manner, enlarging the macular hole area to get better closer pattern in your post-op period. Now, you can stain the ILM also with the help of Titan glue. Titan glue can stain ILM, but it can stain very faintly, like in this case. You can just peel the ILM in a clockwise manner. And after the, doing the ILM peeling, the next step is fluid air exchange. So fluid air exchange can be done with the help of suction, this thing only, and also just drain the macular hole. This will make the hole margin little bit closer. Another, like in large macular hole cases, sometimes inverted flap techniques, it is for last few years, it is giving very good result for, I think, all of us. So creating the, making the inverted flap in this technique, you can assure the your closer pattern and try to keep your temporal hinge of ILM for the inverted flap. Like when you are doing fluid exchange, your flap can inverted again over the macular hole, or you can reposition the flap with the help of tano scratcher, like in this case. So this is the inverted flap technique. Another situation, partial thickness macular hole. This is the, also the principle is same. After doing vitrectomy, you have to stain the ERM with the help of N-gasin forceps, as well as then you have to stain the ILM part, and finally you have to check the vitreous base again and again to rule out for any other break. For microfoveous crisis is also a very important, there is splitting of the all retinal layers, inner and outer retinal layers will be split out. In this type of situation, like anterior to the retinal surface, all the taut things has to be removed. Taut membranes has to be removed, like in this case, where I stained the ERM part with the help of SCISIS part of the whole posterior hyoid face, and stained with the transuranostenite, and removing the vitreous crisis part, and this has to be managed very keenly. And then you have to peel the ILM with the help of debridement and huge eye and try to do good ILM peeling. It is very much necessary to do the ILM peeling, and recently all the reports are showing that ILM peeling is mandatory for myopic foveous crisis.